member of the Ministers Conference of Winston-Salem and Vicinity, Bishop Fulton. Thank you for giving me this time, and to all of you for your leadership here in Winston-Salem, North Carolina. I am indeed home. And I'm grateful because of the leadership, everyone who leads here with the Ministers Conference. I'm grateful that Bishop Fulton said, McCoy, bring your book with you. And I was most grateful for that because I haven't actually formally presented the book yet. But I'm going to do that here at home. And so I'm grateful for that opportunity as well. The book that God led me to write is entitled, That Child, Preparing for Challenging Moments with Youth. I've had the opportunity to visit many churches, to conduct many workshops, as we wrestle with how to work with young people in faith communities, in our homes, in schools, in our community. How do we work with these young people today? So, since I have been blessed to have those invitations, I thought I'd put some of that stuff in a book. Yeah. So I did indeed bring this book with me. And so on this afternoon, I want to talk about one of the concepts from my book. One of the concepts is simply the STAR principle. So on this afternoon, I want to talk about the STAR principle. All right. There is a great Olympian whom you may be familiar with. Her name is Simone Biles. This young lady is indeed phenomenal. But you see, what she wanted to do was not follow in someone else's footsteps. She wanted to make her impact in her own way. But sexist coverage of the Rio Olympics said, oh, she is the next Michael Phelps. She is the next Usain Bolt. Miss Biles came out and said, I am not the next Usain Bolt or Michael Phelps. I am the first Simone Biles. You see, young people are pressured all the time to follow someone else's star. Unfortunately, as we grow older, we still are compelled many times to follow someone else's star. There is an African proverb that I read, and it simply says, don't set sail using someone else's star. This is where the concept was birthed of the STAR principle.
Come on.
It is that I'm trying to encourage us to find value in our own potential. No matter how old you are, the world will try to make you think that you're not good enough. You need to be like someone else. There's a lot of preachers in here. You need to preach like someone else. Your church needs to be ran like someone else. And I'm not saying that we should not find value in models. But when you discount your own abilities, that's when the problem comes. So I want to make sure that I encourage young people. You see, it was Frederick Douglass who said that it is easier to build strong children than to repair broken men. So before they get to where we are, they need to understand that there is value in who they are and where they are and in who God made them. And so in my book, I focus on 1 Samuel chapter 18, verses 6 and 9 to help illuminate my principle. This is what is happening. A very familiar passage of scripture. When the men were returning home after David had killed the Philistine, the women came out from all the towns of Israel to meet King Saul, with singing and dancing, with joyful songs, and with timbrels and lyres. As they danced, they sang, Saul has slain his thousands, and David his tens of thousands. Saul was very angry. This refrain displeased him greatly. They have credited David with tens of thousands, he thought. But me, with only thousands. What more can he get but the kingdom? And from that time on, Saul kept a close eye on David. So you see, I use this particular passage to illuminate the star principle. Because the first thing that this text tells us is that when we focus on someone else or someone else's star, it robs us of our own attention.
Yes.
Saul did not even acknowledge the fact that the women came out for him.
Wow.
The text says that the women came out to meet King Saul. One can miss his own party.
Yeah.
You can be the guest.
Yeah.
Yet miss your own part. He robbed himself of the attention. You see, just because David's star was bright didn't mean that it was the brightest star. I learned that some stars are extremely bright, but they just can't be seen by the naked eye.
Yeah.
So what is bright about your ministry that you fail to see?
Come on, Bridget.
Are you just looking at your ministry with the naked eye?
Yeah.
Or are you considering the fact that you are able to see some things when you see them through the eyes of God? Mm-hmm. Whatever happened to faith?
Yeah.
Looking through that lens. Yeah. The fact is, some of us are suffering from spiritual blindness.
Yeah.
We have eyes, but we do not see.
Yeah.
So God is trying to give us an eye exam, if you will.
Yeah.
As bright as your star is, you do not see.
Yeah.
King Saul is robbed of his attention. These women came out to meet King Saul. But not only that, as they danced and they sang, Saul allowed these people to determine his worth.
Yeah.
And that's a tricky one there. Because again, in our society, they're always trying to tell us what we are, what we're not, what we should be, what we should not be. He's allowing outsiders to determine his worth. He's not considering his past successes.
Yeah, wow.
He's not considering the potential of his future success. His plans for his future are ignored. David's star looks brighter.
Right.
So Saul allows a song and a dance to take away his creativity. What are you allowing to take away your creativity? What is extinguishing the creativity in your ministry? His creativity is extinguished. Because again, he's focusing on the ladies. And one of my pastor friends said, well, McCoy, you have to understand, it would have been different if men were singing and dancing.
Yeah.
But McCoy, these were women. And a lot of times the men care about what the women think.
Yeah.
This is why we try to encourage our young men to pull up their pants. And then we tell the young girls, make sure that you date the guy that pulls up his pants. Because you see, they care about what you think, young ladies.
Yeah.
It's a man's world, but it wouldn't be nothing.
Hey!
Without a woman or a girl.
Yeah.
So perhaps King Saul was bothered because it was the women.
Yeah.
Saying, I don't know much about it, but maybe that extinguished his fire. And it's interesting that Saul was so angry. He was so very angry and displeased to the point where he decided to keep his eye on David. The text says that from that time on, verse 9, Saul kept a close eye on David. His entire kingdom was threatened by David. David did not even have the authority, the power, or the position of king. Yet, he was threatened by David.
Yeah.
His entire kingdom was threatened by his own internal dialogue. What you say to yourself.
Yes.
You see, we can place a lot of things on the Democrats and the Republicans, on the blacks and the whites, on the men and the women, on all of these isms. I understand they are real.
Yeah.
But do you know that your mind is real?
Yeah.
So then I try to encourage young people to watch what you say to yourself. Because internal dialogue is a powerful thing.
Yeah.
So what I have, even in this book, is a short activity for us as adults to use with young people, whether they be your children, whether they be your grandchildren, whether they be in your church, in your Bible study class, in your youth group, whether they're kids that are at risk and you take your time to work with those kids. This is in the book for to guide us on this idea of the STAR principle. What I say is, give every child a sheet of paper and tell them to draw a picture of a boat on a lake with stars in the sky. Every child will do this. Once they finish their drawing, tell them to exchange those sheets of paper. Have them really look at it. Have them take the time to see the variations in the drawings. Yeah. Let them see that this boat doesn't look like this boat.
Come on, man.
And these stars don't look like these stars. Yeah. But everybody has their own boat that's life.
Yeah. Yeah.
Everybody has a lake that's God leading them somewhere. And everybody's got some stars.
Yeah.
But the question is, are you going to focus on everybody else's star?
Yeah.
Or are you going to find value in the uniqueness of your own star?
Yeah. Come on.
So the idea is once they finish this particular drawing, once they've completed this activity, they find value in what they are able to create. They find value in the differences.
Yeah.
And then what they see is at the end of the day, we're not all that different. So I read a lot about stars, and I found that during the day, stars are still there. It's just that the sky is so bright that we can't see them. But once the sky is fully dark, oh, how bright the stars shine. So I want to encourage each and every one of us today. If your ministry seems dark, if the prayers seem like they're not being answered, you're in the dark. If your church seems like it's not growing, you're in the dark. If the sermons seem like the people just don't seem to get and you feel like you're in the dark, again, don't worry about that, because in the dark is when the stars shine the brightest.
Yeah.
So you see, you're in a good place. The dark is a good place.
Yeah.
Because only then can we see certain stars. And remember what Jesus said. Jesus commanded us to let our light shine before men.
Yeah.
Well, sometimes that's going to happen in the dark.
Yeah.
When your life is low. When things feel like you're down and you almost feel like you're out, that's the best time to shine. When you don't really know what the next step is, it just seems like it's dark, that's the best time to shine.
Yeah.
You see, sometimes as adults, we need to go back to our youth. You remember the song that they taught you when you were a little boy, don't you? You remember the song that they taught you when you were a little girl, don't you?
Yeah.
Don't you remember that song when it said, this little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. It does not say when to let it shine. It does not say just let it shine when things are good. It says everywhere I go, I'm going to let it shine. Everywhere I go, I'm going to let it shine. It's not contingent upon how things are going in your life right now. If God has called you to shine, the stars don't get to say, I'm not going to do it. If they did, each and every one of us would be in disarray.
Yeah.
Because we would say, I haven't seen a star in a long time.
Yeah.
Was somebody saying,